In the eastern part of the Mediterranean, in the middle of the Aegean Sea, shores blessed by the gods. The sea is clear, warm, and a steady breeze tempers the scorching sun.
Life was sweet on the island of Strongoli in the year 2000 BC. The islanders cultivated the land, tended their sheep, decorated their homes, and made ornate vases, dividing their time between fishing and farming. The phenomenon was of unprecedented violence, undoubtedly the greatest cataclysm in recorded history. We can piece together what happened over 3,500 years ago on this little island in the Cyclades.
It all started with an incredible series of eruptions which shook the cone of the volcano at the heart of the island. The volcano spewed such quantities of magma that its reservoir emptied, turning the cone into a gigantic hollow chamber.
The catastrophe reached its climax when the ceiling of the chamber collapsed. The island literally caved in upon itself, and the ocean flooded in, filling a gaping hole of some 10 kilometers in diameter.
In a single terrible day and night, the island of Atlantis sank into the sea and disappeared.
Who knows if it was not these deep waters which swallowed up Atlantis, of which Plato first spoke. The caldera, or cauldron-like crater, is gigantic, 60 cubic kilometers in volume. Boats can't even anchor here, for the ocean floor is 300 meters deep. Of Strongyli's once round cone, only a shattered crown remains.
The pumice stones found on the neighboring islands, and even far from the site of the cataclysm, gives us an idea of the intensity of the eruption. The shores of Crete were battered by a tidal wave. The sound of the volcano's explosion was heard as far off as Egypt. And the emerged arc, all that remained of the island, was covered by 60 meters of pumice.
The island is an enormous mass of lava. The ground is not part of the Earth's crust, but made of a thick, burning liquid which gushes from the Earth's entrails and dries like blood on a wound, darkish red and black.
After the catastrophe, when calm returned to the island, a new city was built high on the cliffs. It probably looked much like the villages still on the island, which then became known as Caliste, a name given to it by the Phoenicians, meaning the beautiful one. Disfigured, the island grew in mystery, grew in charm. Later, Theras would found a colony here and called the island Thera. Today, the island is also commonly known as Santorini, in other words, Saint Irene.
The cataclysm which so drastically disrupted the profile of Santorini is but one episode in an eventful history that is still unfolding. In the 16th and 18th centuries, two flat oblong volcanoes appeared in the center of the caldera, Mikra and Nea Kamini. Kamini's last eruption only dates back to 1950. And even more recently, on July 9, 1956, an earthquake shook the archipelago for over 40 seconds, killing 50 people. Santorini is unique. It is the only island in the world, besides Krakatoa in Indonesia, to have literally exploded.
The birth of a volcano at sea is a relatively more common phenomenon and can even give rise to diplomatic incidents. In 1831, a few hundred kilometers away, a volcano arose from the sea between Sicily and Tunisia. The Italians named it Ferdinandea, the English Gran, and the French Julia. All were hoping to appropriate it and tension mounted. The volcano, however, restored the peace a few months later by disappearing back into the sea.
On November 14, 1963, in the much colder seas of Iceland, fishermen watched a new island rise up out of the ocean before their very eyes. The island of Surtsey was born in a single night, a few hundred fathoms off the southern coast of Iceland. There was no warning sign of eruption, no tremors recorded, just a slight odor of sulfur in the Icelandic air 3 days before eruption.
The island didn't immediately take on the appearance it has today. It grew, its contours changed, due to the eruptions that for almost 3 years periodically rocked the crater called Surtur. Less than 2 years after the volcano's birth, researchers observed the first traces of plant life on the island. Seeds carried by the wind or birds were thriving. Surtsey is now an integral part of the Westman Islands, the Vestmanneyjar. All the islands in the Westman Archipelago were formed by underwater volcanic activity, but Surtsey is the second largest, just after Himeji.
Just a few kilometers away, 10 years after the birth of Surtsey, this island was the stage for a major episode in volcanology. No one around here will ever forget the night of January 23, 1973. The Helgafell, the sacred mountain, a volcano everyone thought extinct, suddenly burst open along a 2 kilometer line, and 20 fountains of lava began belching from the gaping fissure. The entire city was threatened by the flying volcanic rock and molten matter that was blasted hundreds of meters into the sky.
During this eruption, a new volcano was formed. It was christened Eldfell. The lava flow was stupendous. Millions of cubic meters poured over Himeji, suddenly enlarging it by over 1 square kilometer. The eruption lasted 5 months. A large part of the city was buried beneath the lava and cinders that spewed out of Eldfell. Thankfully, the inhabitants remained calm, and with the immediate proximity of the sea, there were no victims.
The island was completely rebuilt. Several gutted homes were preserved as a constant reminder that in this part of Europe, more than in any other, volcanoes should never be considered definitively extinct.
These phenomena, observable almost everywhere in Iceland, are the ever-present signs of continuous and pervasive volcanic activity. When not in an eruptive phase, the great Icelandic volcanoes are not extremely spectacular. Often hidden by snow or ice, they can easily be mistaken for mountains or glacier formations. All the major volcanic structures here are glacial, permanently covered with hundreds of meters of ice.
But even the most untrained eye can see, in its contours and colors, a clear indication of Iceland's origin. This land of ice is also a land of fire. The island, with its 100,000 square kilometers, is unique in that it is exclusively composed of volcanic rock.
Iceland is in fact made up of a string of volcanoes that emerged in the midst of the Atlantic Ocean, along a gigantic gash in the Earth's crust. It's a must, a paradise for all those trying to unravel the history of our planet and its volcanoes. But in the early days of volcanology, Iceland was distant, and scientists kept to the old world.
Understanding the Earth's landscapes was not always as easy as it seems today. These cones and domes in the heart of France's Auvergne region were first thought to be slag heaps, or even giant forge furnaces built by the Romans. It wasn't until the middle of the 18th century that the truth came out, and the Puy, as they are called, were recognized as a chain of volcanoes. In 1751, Jean-Étienne Guettard, a distinguished physician and mineralogist, undertook a journey to the center of France. On his random excursions, he noticed that a black porous stone was often used there. It reminded him of lava samples from Vesuvius that he'd seen in a collection belonging to the Duke of Orléans. Guettard inquired as to the source of this stone, used for so many purposes here. He was told that it came from the Volvic quarries. He went there himself, and although he had never seen a volcano in his life, he was soon convinced.
I easily recognized that the Puy de Dôme, as well as Volvic Mountain, were once volcanoes. Everything indicates this. In the areas not covered with plants and trees, the ground is exclusively composed of pumice stone, chunks of lava, and a kind of sand or gravel formed by a type of cinder, and very small pumice stones mixed with sand.
Some of the still intact volcanic bombs on the Puy de la Vache allow us to imagine the violence of the eruptions that shook this region less than 10,000 years ago. The Puy chain is considered one of the most beautiful groups of volcanic formations in Europe. 90 volcanoes are squeezed into a 5-kilometer-wide strip that stretches for almost 50 kilometers.
These volcanoes have a wide variety of shapes. However, we can identify two major types, cones and domes. Puy de Dôme is the highest and most well-known. Its 1,464-meter peak dominates the entire chain. The Gauls, and later the Romans, built temples at the volcano's summit. The Roman temple was dedicated to Mercury, otherwise known as Dumias, from which the mountain's current name is derived.
It was at the Puy de Dôme that, in 1648, Blaise Pascal demonstrated the weight of air by comparing the height of a column of mercury at the volcano's peak with that of a column at the bottom at Clermont-Ferrand. The Puy chain contains only 8 domes. Strombolian-type cones are the most common.
Puy de Dôme is one of the most remarkable. What makes it special is that it has 2 craters, one inside the other. As for Puy de Pariou, it is sometimes considered the Vesuvius of the Auvergne region.
It made a great impression on Leopold von Buch, the most renowned geologist of the 19th century. Because of its elegant silhouette, he considered it the model volcano. In fact, von Buch was totally enthralled by the Auvergne mountains and went so far as to write,
"If you want to see volcanoes, choose Clermont-Ferrand rather than Etna or Vesuvius."
Regardless of what von Buch said, the grapes of Lacrima Christi still ripen in the Bay of Naples' sun, as they have for 20 centuries, and the great volcano on which they thrive still attracts more tourists than any other in the world. Vesuvius's renown is inextricably linked to the fate of the people who lived here in the year 79 AD. They suddenly saw the familiar hilltop start smoking, and within minutes, it was spewing tons of burning cinders over them. The Roman writer Pliny the Younger later described these hellish moments in a letter to Tacitus. It gives us an exact and moving eyewitness account and is the first written document on volcanology.
"Cinders began falling on us, though in small quantities. I turned and saw a thick black fog threatening to overtake us, following us like a torrent spreading across the ground. Let's make a detour, I said, while we can still see, for fear of being knocked down in the road and crushed in the shadows by the crowd of those fleeing with us. We were barely seated when the sky went dark. Not the darkness of a moonless night in cloudy weather, but the darkness of a closed room in which all lights have been extinguished. We heard women moaning, babies wailing, and men shouting. Some were calling out to their fathers and mothers. Others called out to their children or their spouses. Some were lamenting their own bad fortune. Others lamented that of their king. A few, fearing death, prayed for it to take them. Many raised their arms to the gods, and more than one among them cried that there were no gods in heaven, that this eternal night would be the world's last."
The eruption lasted 3 days and killed thousands. Life stopped at Pompeii for centuries to come. It was more than 1,500 years later before the first trace of the city was at last discovered. And it would be another 200 before the excavations began. When Pompeii was at last liberated from its cinder shroud, the city was revealed as it once was, a pleasant and lively city center stretching over 1 square kilometer where some 20,000 people had lived.
When visiting Pompeii, one has the almost religious feeling of witnessing an exhumation. The life of the ancient city seems incredibly close. By petrifying the city in a single blast, Vesuvius performed a paradoxical feat, destroying everything while preserving it for all time.
The little city of Herculaneum suffered the same fate during the eruption, except the city was not buried by cinders, but drowned by a river of mud. Torrential rains washed the cinders that accumulated on the volcanic cone down into the valley. A veritable river of boiling mud swept down Vesuvius, clearing everything in its path, trees, columns, statues, entire walls of homes. Other homes were completely drowned under this mire that seeped into every nook and cranny. A few of Herculaneum's 5,000 inhabitants had time to flee, but many were killed. As it dried, the volcanic mud hardened, and this baked mud tomb had to be broken to liberate the ruins. Important archaeological remains are still entombed, but are now hard to excavate because the modern city has grown on top of them.
A natural conclusion to the visit of these two devastated cities seems to be a trip to the top of Vesuvius. Guided tours were already being organized here in the early 19th.
Vesuvius was indeed a forerunner, since the world's first volcanological observatory was founded here in 1841. Vesuvius, being close and accessible, proved to be an excellent observation ground for early volcanologists. Later, men of letters throughout Europe would be swept up in a romantic craze for this fiery mountain. Goethe, Byron, Lamartine, and Chateaubriand all climbed to the crater's rim. On January 5, 1804, the French writer Chateaubriand notes,
"I left Naples at 7 o'clock in the morning, and am already at Portici. The sun has appeared through the dawn clouds. I bargain with a guide to drive me to the volcano's crater. He provides me with 2 mules, one for him, one for me. We are leaving. Scorched earth everywhere. Naked vines among umbrella-shaped pines, a few aloe veras in hedges, countless boulders, and not one bird. The lava, like slag spewing from a forge, is black and covered with a whitish dross remarkably similar to dried foam. The overall color of the pit is that of extinguished coal. I ponder that, a short distance below my feet, lies a fiery pit. I imagine that the volcano might open up and throw me into the air with these slabs of shattered marble."
Vesuvius's crater has a perfect shape today, but it didn't look like this when it spewed cinders over Pompeii. This crater appeared just afterwards, fitting into the earlier volcanic structure, the Soma, and disfiguring it over time.
Thank you.
Today, Vesuvius's crater reaches 1,281 meters in altitude. It is 580 meters long, 480 meters wide, and 300 meters deep. In 1906, it was three times larger. It owes its current contour to the last eruption of 1944. Today, Vesuvius is extinct. Or is it merely dormant? Who can say? In any case, it's the most closely monitored volcano in the world.
Here's another example of volcanic activity in the area around the Bay of Naples. Monte Nuovo, a crater 400 meters wide and 120 meters deep, which suddenly appeared in the 16th century on the ruins of a Roman village near Cicero's ancient villa. Five kilometers from Monte Nuovo, there's another famous volcanic landmark, Solfatara, with its white rocks of cinder and pumice. This unique crater is known for its fields of smoking vents and pools of boiling mud. It belongs to a group of volcanoes known as the Phlegraean Fields.
The island of Ischia, the largest of the Campani Islands, lies 40 kilometers off the coast of Naples. Ischia is a volcanic offspring of the Phlegraean Fields. It's pockmarked with old craters, but the odor of sulfur gave way centuries ago to the fragrant perfume of pines and exotic flowers. Traveling south from Ischia, less than 80 kilometers from the shores of Sicily, we find a volcanic archipelago known as the Aeolian, or Lipari Islands. As legend has it, these islands were once part of an entire continent, Tyrrhenia, which is said to have crumbled into the sea during a violent earthquake. Today, the archipelago is composed of seven major islands, all of them infinitely charming. About half of them are perfectly dormant, but the others show clear signs of volcanic activity.
Lipari is the largest island in the chain. Despite its volcanic origin, we can see from the island's pleasant and peaceful appearance that it has not experienced an eruption for a long time. Indeed, the craters seem to be definitively extinct here as of the 6th century. This estimate is based not only on archaeological excavations, but also carbon-14 dating. In addition, it supports a local legend. A hermit living on Lipari is said to have chased the fiery devils from these obsidian and pumice craters in the year 550 AD. Near Foggia Vecchia and Monte Pilato, we can see some handsome obsidian formations.
Obsidian, also known as volcanic glass, resembles dark bottle glass. It is lava which has cooled very quickly, preventing the formation of crystals. It's essentially composed of silica. Prehistoric peoples took advantage of obsidian's glass-like quality to make sharp-edged tools. In the Neolithic era, obsidian objects from Lipari were common throughout the Mediterranean basin.
Obsidian is as dark and compact as pumice stone is pale and light. So light, in fact, that it floats on water. And we find pumice on the shores of all the Aeolian islands, even on the beaches of Sicily and southern Italy. A highly respected volcanologist, the late Maurice Kraft, gave a good description of pumice when he called it a kind of lava foam. Pumice has been mined here since early antiquity. The Romans used it to build the Colosseum and the villas of Pompeii. Today, pumice is used in toothpaste. Several thousand miners on Lipari work at excavating this 200-meter-deep layer of pumice that stretches over 8 square kilometers.
Volcano Island is less than 600 meters south of Lipari. Only a shallow channel separates them, but they seem worlds apart, the distance between active and dormant volcanism. Volcano has a harsh, desolate look. The ground looks like stone, and the stone is the color of fire.
Over its 20 square kilometer surface, Volcano demonstrates in every possible manner that its volcanism is very much alive. This becomes all the more obvious as, clouded in the odor of sulfur, one approaches the great crater, La Fossa. The last eruption here dates back to 1888, not that long ago. And volcanologists predict that the crater may enter a new cycle of activity in the very near future.
One must travel to the northern tip of the archipelago, to the most famous of the Aeolian Islands, to sense, if not the danger, at least the power of the only constantly eruptive volcano in Europe. The color of the rocks and beaches on Stromboli immediately identify it as volcanic. In the northeast part of the island, the magnificent and massive Strombolicchio overlook the Mediterranean from a height of 43 meters. It's a neck, a remnant of one of the volcano's parasitic cones.
Mount Stromboli is a model volcano. Its perfect cone shape is what earned it its name, Stromboli being derived from an ancient word meaning a child's top. It's hard to resist the temptation of climbing up to the crater's rim, even though the trail is long and rocky. A climb to an altitude of 924 meters. But this isn't the volcano's full height. Its slopes extend 2,000 meters further below sea level.
Once at the crater's rim, however, we miss the show. Today, the wind-driven fog and smoke make it impossible to see the flying cinders and ribbons of lava spewing from the volcano's five mouths. There's still the sound of the explosions, of lava beating against the volcano walls, and the resplendent dawn over the Aeolians. About 100 kilometers to the south is an extraordinary land, Sicily. The crossroads of the Mediterranean, the center of antiquity, Trinacria, the land of three points. This is a land where the world's greatest civilizations have left their mark, mixing heroes and gods, confusing truth and legend.
The Piazza Armerina is an ancient Roman villa renowned for the beauty of its mosaics. This one of young girls in their bathing suits is famous the world over. A mosaic in one of the rooms in the villa depicts Polyphemus the Cyclop throwing boulders at Ulysses' ship to prevent him from escaping. The story continues off the port of Acitreza, where the Cyclops' boulders are said to have fallen. Polyphemus's bad aim is understandable because he was so far away, on Mount Etna, in fact, where he was helping Hephaestus, the god of fire, forge the god's weapons in the underground furnace amidst the thundering of hammers, flying sparks, and smoke.
Mount Etna is the largest volcano in Europe. It measures an impressive 48 kilometers from north to south and 38 kilometers from east to west. Its volume is estimated at 600 cubic kilometers. Its massive shape is visible from anywhere in Sicily. The Sicilians also call it Mongibello, or the Mountain of Mountains. Indeed, Etna is first and foremost a mountain, rising to 3,350 meters and covered with a thick layer of snow in winter and spring.
Mongibello has always inspired fascination. In 490 BC, a philosopher from Agrigente, by the name of Empedocles, feeling that he would never succeed in piercing the volcano's mysteries, threw himself into the crater's mouth in despair. Aeschylus, Plato, Aristotle, all speak of Etna. In recorded history, the volcano's dormant phases have been rare. Etna is known to erupt an average of 15 times a century, an indication of the menace this mountain represents, and explains why it is locally also known as the Viper.
As the eruptions are frequent and powerful, it's surprising to find so many homes and farms on the slopes of the volcano. The reason is that the lava soil turned out to be extremely fertile, a godsend in Sicily, where the soil is usually so arid. Already in ancient times, Strabo had noticed that the rich volcanic ash at the foot of the volcano very quickly became fruitful.
The tubers grown in areas covered with ash put so much fat on the herds that they choke. From sea level to an altitude of 1,200 meters are terraced groves of orange and lemon trees, and vineyards which give a wine that has a powerful taste with a touch of sulfur.
The harvest is plentiful, why heed the danger? If by some misfortune Edna awakens, the farmers will pray the patron saints, imploring them for a miracle such as one of the many that have marked the volcano's history. On February 5th, 253 AD, a river of lava was advancing upon the city of Catania. The inhabitants carried the shroud from their martyr's sepulchre and held it up before the moving lava. The burning flood separated, then stopped. Unfortunately, the miracle didn't repeat itself during the terrible eruption of 1669, and this time, one-third of the city disappeared under the burning torrents. The cathedral in the small town of Nicolosi, built from lava rock, bears witness that the people of this land have bound their fate to that of the volcano. Shapes homes and colors the landscape.
Oddly enough, more people now lose their lives on Etna due to bad weather than to eruptions. Disorientated and exhausted, they get lost in the snow and icy fog on this shapeless monster.
Lava flows with the characteristic sound of breaking glass. Etna is what specialists call an eruptive volcano. The viscosity of the lava determines the speed of the flow. First escapes, lava flows at speeds of 1 to several meters per second, but occasionally the flow can attain a speed of 20 meters per second.
beneath the fog, 2 kilometers from the source, the lava's temperature still reaches close to 1,000 degrees centigrade. This incredible bank of lava advances at several centimeters per second.
The fate of the trees condemned by the lava flow is rather tragic, as the volcanologist Harwin Taziev describes it.
Often they die standing. They're standing but dead. The reason is that, despite the temperature and the incredible quantity of heat it's carrying, the lava cannot ignite the wood and foliage, or even grasses, until it evaporates all the water from the plants. And plants are primarily composed of water. Grasses and leaves wither in a few seconds, ignite suddenly and are gone. As for trees, it takes much longer for the lava to evaporate the ton or even tons of water they hold.
Years before Christ, Virgil was fascinated by the same spectacle. Convinced the volcano was the home of the gods, he wrote,
"Etna thunders with terrible eruptions. Sometimes the mountain throws a black cloud, swirling with dark smoke and incandescent cinders into the ether. Sometimes it spits out boulders torn from its entrails. Bellowing, it piles liquid stones into the sky from its boiling depths. Enormous Etna exhales flames from its gaping ovens, and each time it turns on its weary side, the whole of Trinacria trembles with a long sigh."